Just before we get started, I do want to say that this video contains some pretty disturbing stuff, and by pretty disturbing stuff, I mean really disturbing stuff. So, you know, viewer discretion is advised. This video is made possible by Hims. If you're a man who wants to keep your hair, ironic, I know, go to forhims.com/brainfood and try Hims for just $5 while supplies last. Medical science has advanced an incredible amount in the last 50 years. In fact, 50 years ago, what we do today would have been considered totally science fiction. By the same token, though, there were things done in the 1950s and 1960s that people today are still skeptical actually happened, like those experiments that resulted in a bunch of two-headed dogs. Said experiments were conducted by Vladimir Demikhov, a Soviet scientist who is noted as being a pioneer in the field of organ transplantation. Dr. Demikhov was responsible for, amongst other things, pioneering the use of immunosuppressants in organ transplants and designing the first mechanical cardiac assist device, essentially the precursor to modern artificial hearts. With this latter device, Demikhov was able to take over the cardiac function of a dog for around 5 hours, an experiment notable for being the first ever in which circulation was maintained in an animal whose heart had been excised. Prior to Demikhov, this was a feat that many people believed to be entirely impossible. Demikhov is also known to have performed the first heart transplant in 1946. In this instance, it was done on a dog. This was a full 21 years before the first human transplant took place and was a major step towards the latter ever happening. It has been noted that Demikhov was a genius whose successes heralded the era of modern heart and lung transplantation. Despite this glowing praise in some circles, his contributions have largely been overlooked outside of the medical community due to the infamy of his latter, more audacious experiments. And as you might imagine, this is the point that we come back to two-headed dogs. Sometime in the early 1950s, spurred on by the success of his experiments involving the transplantation of organs in dogs, including several experiments in which he'd managed to successfully transplant multiple organs of the same type into the same animal, Demikhov began toying with the idea of transplanting the most valuable organ of all. And that's, of course, the brain. Demikhov is said to have been inspired by the work of Dr. Sergei Brukhonenko, another Soviet medical pioneer known for inventing a machine capable of artificially stimulating the functionality of the heart and lungs, albeit on a temporary basis. Like Demikhov, the work of Brukhonenko is largely overlooked due to an experiment involving dogs. In Brukhonenko's case, he infamously kept the decapitated heads of several dogs alive using the aforementioned machine for a number of hours, proving that it was possible to keep the brain alive and functional after almost unthinkable trauma. Footage of these experiments actually appears in a documentary that was released in 1940 with the rather appropriate title, Experiments in the Revival of Organisms. However, the veracity of this footage, which shows a decapitated dog's head connected to a heart and lung machine blinking and responding to various stimuli, has been the topic of heated debate for many years, and even to this day, there's no agreement on whether it actually shows what it claims. To be clear, Brukhonenko's experiments on reanimation are well documented, and there's little doubt he actually did it. However, there is some uncertainty about whether the particular documentary actually shows real experiments or whether it was a reenactment of sorts after the fact for propaganda purposes. Alright, so let's get back to Demikhov. Well, his idea was as simple as it was shocking. He would prove that the brain, like any other organ, could be successfully transplanted by cutting the head off a dog, keeping it alive using the same technology as Brukhonenko had done, and then transplanting that head onto the body of another dog. All in all, it's recorded that Demikhov performed this experiment over 24 times with varying degrees of success. Success in this context was defined as the subjects of the operation surviving the ordeal and then displaying some awareness of their surroundings, as well as the ability to respond to stimuli. After successful transplants, the dogs typically died days later as a result of immune responses. Of course, scientists, being good scientists, many were skeptical that Demikhov could actually perform such a procedure successfully, and they wanted direct proof. So, to silence the skeptics, Demikhov invited Life magazine to document and photograph one of his experiments in 1959. The resulting article, titled Russia Two-Headed Dog, documented the entire transplant process, including the preliminary preparations, during which Demikhov introduced the journalist writing the article to the two dogs that were about to be sewn together. Shavka, a small 9-year-old female, and Brogyaga, a large stray of which little was known. Demikhov then further endeared himself to any potential readers by saying that Brogyaga was Russian for tramp, and that he personally felt the dog was quite lucky since two heads are better than one. Prior to the operation, Demikhov also introduced the interviewing journalist to a dog called Palmer, which he revealed had two hearts thanks to an operation he performed on the animal a few days earlier. The article culminated in Shavka's head and forelegs being successfully grafted onto Brodyaga's body. The operation was such a success, in fact, that Shavka's decapitated head was even able to lap a few mouthfuls of water from a bowl with some assistance. This is something he did purely for the cameras, because the dog's throat was not attached to the other dog's stomach, meaning it couldn't gain any nourishment from food or water via normal means. In the end, the two dogs survived for 4 days before dying from complications from the surgery. This was actually a bit of a surprise to Demikhov, who revealed that some of his previous subjects had survived for as long as 29 days. Despite the potential implications of Demikhov's research, this particular bit of his life's work was largely dismissed by the wider scientific community, with the exception of a few scientists. One of the most notable was American neuroscientist Dr. Robert White. Dr. White infamously and successfully repeated the experiment using rhesus monkeys in the 1970s. While the two experiments were basically the same and set out to prove the same point, that a full head transplant was possible, there were a number of differences. Beyond the fact that a monkey head transplant is much closer to the procedure needed for a human head transplant, which is the end goal of this research, Demikhov had attached the head of one dog to the body of another still living dog, while White went one step further and transplanted the head of one monkey onto another headless monkey body. Doing this meant that, with the exception of the spinal cord, every major artery and even the windpipe and throat could be connected successfully to the new host body, allowing for more or less normal body function, other than the typical issues associated with paralysis. What's more, the transplanted monkey head retained full awareness of its surroundings to such an extent that literally the first thing it did upon regaining consciousness was bite the finger of the medical assistant. With these results in hand, White concluded that performing the same surgery on a human would soon be possible, and the person would not only potentially survive, but suffer few ill effects other than the obviously then irreversible damage to their spinal cord. Something that wouldn't be an issue for terminal quadriplegics, who White felt would be the best candidates for such a procedure. However, he also stated, "Whether such dramatic procedures will ever be justified in the human area must wait not only upon the continued advance of medical science, but more appropriately, the moral and social justification of such procedural undertakings." Others have also taken up the research area, despite the ethical controversy, citing the massive benefits such procedures would provide to countless individuals, such as those with terminal cancer, severe muscular atrophy, paralysis from the neck down, people with multiple organ failure, etc. Essentially, it would be useful for anyone who has an otherwise fully functional brain, but whose life support systems, in some comprising their body, are failing in some way, which ultimately would cause the premature death of the brain. As to the current state of this brand of research, Italian neurosurgeon Sergio Canavero states that he expects the technology to be ready in the not-too-distant future, which will allow him to perform a successful human head transplant. Not satisfied to leave the head transplanted individual paralyzed, Dr. Canavero even managed to re-knit the spinal cord of a rat after severing it, allowing the animal to eventually regain control of its body. German researchers in 2014 also reported similar success repairing a severed spinal cord in a rat using a similar technique. Said Canavero, "The experiment is an important piece of our puzzle because now we know for sure that it is possible for a spinal cord to grow back together." Beyond Dr. Canavero, arguably the world leader in head transplants, is Dr. Ren Xiaoping of China, who has led a team that has made significant advancements in the procedures in this area. Dr. Canavero relatively recently commented on Dr. Xiaoping's work that, "I can tell you that within the last 18 months, about 1,000 similar surgeries were performed in China, and I can say that this very rat, the one with the repaired spinal cord, is not the best sample. We will say more as soon as the information is published in the scientific magazines, because until then, it is restricted by copyright." As for Dr. Xiaoping, he noted of the ethics of the procedure that back when things like human heart transplants were first becoming a real possibility, there was just as much controversy. He stated, "Many people say a head transplant is not ethical, but what is the essence of a person? A person is the brain, not the body. The body is just an organ. Essentially, the body is just a magnificent life support system. For some, theirs fails, resulting in an otherwise healthy brain that might have lived for many more years, dying as well. Beyond practicing procedures on cadavers, presently Dr. Xiaoping and his team have successfully transplanted numerous heads of rats and other animals onto new host bodies, including transplanting monkey heads, which, as previously noted, is a relatively similar procedure to transplanting a human head. Dr. Xiaoping reported that currently a monkey head transplant takes approximately 20 hours to complete, and he expects that a human head transplant would take an additional 10 to 20 hours. However, before Dr. Xiaoping is willing to try the procedure on an otherwise terminal human patient, he stated that advancements still need to be made to ensure an extremely high probability of success. Towards this end, he and his team are working on improving methods to cut the spinal cord cleanly enough to allow for a high probability of reconnecting the spinal cord in the new body, advancements in suppressing organ rejection, and the ability to maintain blood pressure to the brain throughout the procedure to ensure no brain damage. Despite the technical obstacles that are remaining and the some degree of public opposition to such human procedures, even if they ultimately are life-saving for many with otherwise terminal conditions, Dr. Xiaoping recently posited, "We are getting closer and closer to our goal of a human head transplants. I don't have a timetable. It's very complex work. We can't say it will happen tomorrow, but I'm not ruling out next year." So as we saw in the video today, medical treatments have come a long way, and that's also the case for hair loss treatments. They're no longer dodgy bottles of some liquid that you can buy off some sketchy internet site. And that brings me around to Hims. Hims provide guys with real solutions to problems related to hair, skin, and other parts of the male body that don't work so well as we get older. Hair loss affects 66% of men by the age of 35, some of us a solid decade earlier than that, but you know, it's too late for me, my hair's not coming back. But 23-year-old version of Simon would have loved the stuff from Hims. If you haven't lost all of your hair yet, there are proper options to help you keep it. Now, this is not some sketchy online Mexican pharmacy where a doctor signs off on something. It's a legitimate medical company with proper doctors giving proper consultations, offering medical-grade solutions that make a real difference in your life. Real medications that can prevent hair loss. So cut out the middleman, expensive drugs, insurance companies, etc. It's private, it's cheaper, it's more convenient. There's really no reason not to go with Hims. So how it works is you head on over to their website, you'll find a link in the description below, you have a private consultation with a doctor who will recommend both prescription and non-prescription products tailored to your needs. You then pay a super reasonable price, no expensive brand name medications, all of the stuff they have is off patent, so you don't pay through the nose. And it's all delivered discreetly to your door. Hair issues, sex issues, these are all issues guys can have, and they're all issues that we're not really big on talking about. So don't have an awkward conversation at your doctor's office, but do solve the problem. And you can support this show by going to forhims.com/brainfood and try Hims for $5 plus tax. You can see the website for full details, so check out hims.com/brainfood today. And now for some bonus facts. Vladimir Demikhov was not the first to graft the head of a dog onto the body of another. That dubious honor goes to Charles Claude Guthrie, who performed such a procedure on May 21, 1908. Unfortunately for him, doing this may well have cost him a Nobel Prize. Guthrie collaborated heavily with French physician Alexis Carrel in vascular surgery research, research that Carrel would, in 1912, win a Nobel Prize in physiology and medicine for. This is despite the fact that some argue it was Guthrie who should have been given the primary credit. It has been proposed that Guthrie's controversial decision to work on head transplants is why he was ignored by the Nobel Prize Committee. And now for another bonus fact. Dogs are commonly eaten in certain regions of Asia, with around 13 to 16 million dogs eaten every year there, or around nearly 4% of the world's canine population. It should be noted, though, that the typical breeds you'd find in people's households as pets are not the ones usually eaten. Rather, as with typical Western meat sources like turkeys, bovines, and chickens, specific breeds have been developed for consumption, such as the hugely popular Nyirongi dog, which is rarely raised for anything else but livestock and is one of the most popular dog breeds to eat. If you're curious, the Nyirongi somewhat resembles a small yellow Labrador. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, please do hit that like button below and don't forget to subscribe. Also, don't forget to check out Hims. Find a link to that in the description below. And as always, thank you for watching.